Penguin Random House Audio presents Paddling My Own Canoe, a solo adventure on the coast of Molokai by Audrey Sutherland. Read for you by Mapuana Makia. Today I tried again to write about Molokai, but the sea was there beyond the open door. I picked up the fins, mask, and snorkel and went down across the sand and rocks in front of my house. Then swam out past the reef. I floated face down, watching and motionless over the depths, ankles twined, arms crossed under my forehead, and dozed off into a light sleep. When I opened my eyes, a dozen fish were hovering under me. Uhu, Maiko, Palani, Manini, Kihikihi. They thought I was a drifting log and found shelter there beneath the quiet hulk. I came back and began. Chapter 1. The Island. Hula Ana, in the Hawaiian language, is a place where it is necessary to swim past a cliff that blocks passage along a coast, a sheer cliff where the sea beats. I first glimpsed the sea cliffs and waterfalls of Molokai while flying by, en route to other islands in the Hawaiian chain. There were no roads, no trails, no people, no access except by sea. Looking down on it was not enough. I wanted to be there, but I couldn't afford to hire a boat. All right, I'd have to swim. The plain window framed the headwall of one small bay, a single 1,000-foot face from the peak to the scree at the shore. Down one corner, a narrow cascade etched a white line on the gray lichened rock, and at its base grew a jungle of pandanus trees. Along the sides of the bay, the ridged arms reached out to enfold it like the paws of a giant sphinx. Underwater, eroded pockets and caves tunneled through the basalt. The shallows and the depths were evident in patterns of pale jade and deep cobalt. Beyond that bay, the cliffs rose even higher. The plane was flying at 3,000 feet, but the top of the wall beside us disappeared into mists above. We crossed a headland and flew low over a serrated plateau. Its top was suddenly sliced open, and the gashed green walls fell aside. At the head of the cleft was another cascade, a thick foaming shaft that plunged over the brink and down to a dark pool, then twisted out to sea. Later, I studied the topographic map that confirmed what I had seen from the air. Where the contour lines were so close together as to be almost solid brown, it meant only one thing, vertical. But between the guarding headlands at each end, the coast was indented by three deep valleys. Was it possible to swim around the cliffs towing a floating pack and to come ashore for camping in the valleys? I wondered and searched the meager reference material. The Atlas of Hawaii, since published, explains the coast very simply. The sea cliff on the north side of East Molokai, one of the highest in the world, is 2,000 to 3,600 feet high. The Guinness Book of World Records says, "Highest sea cliff, North Molokai, Hawaiian Islands, 3,600 feet." But in 1957, there were few descriptions. Fewer than 50 miles separate Molokai from the 500,000 people of Honolulu, but until tourist promotion labeled Molokai the Friendly Island, it was known as the Lonely One. Its western end is flat and dry, with pineapple acreage, scrubby thorn trees, and hot golden beaches. The eastern half is jagged mountains, and on the north side where the cliffs catch the moisture-laden clouds blown in by the trade winds and rainfall is 200 inches a year, there are eroded chasms, rainforest slopes, and 1,000 waterfalls. Some tumble directly into the sea below. Others are blown up again and out by the fierce updrafts of the winds, and the air is heavy and salty with the mist of these upside-down falls. White seafoam swirls around a dozen black rock islands, tossed offshore by a giant hand. It is the most isolated and spectacular seacoast in all Hawaii. Some inner wildness, there since childhood, surged up and answered that wild country and said very simply, "Yes, I'll come. It would be possible to walk part of that coast. From the air, I had seen a narrow edge of fallen boulders between some of the vertical faces and the water. 5 flat ledges extended seaward a few hundred feet. For most of the way, though, the cliffs dropped straight into the sea. In the winter, if you can call it winter, when the temperature drops from 80 degrees to 70, the swells and storms move down to Hawaii from the North Pacific. The waves that roll onto the gradual slopes of Oahu's north shore are world famous in the sport of surfing. But along the north coast of Molokai, there are no gradual slopes. The submarine canyons are deep. There is no land from there to Alaska, and the winter waves crash and climb 50 feet up the cliffs. So I must go in summer. Then is the best chance for calm water, but there is no guarantee. In 3 hours, the sea can change from a liquid lapping among the rocks to an 8-foot shore break, and the wind will rise from a breath to a 40-knot gale. The current and the winds move west, parallel to the coastline. I cannot swim against them. From the east end of the island at Halawa Valley, I must go all the way to the peninsula of Kalaupapa, where there is a trail out and also a small airstrip. West of Halawa, the rainfall increases. The cliffs become higher, more verdant, and more sheer. Once started, there would be no return. Chapter 2. Preparing. I was inexperienced in amphibious journeys, but other preparation had been going on for a long time without my realizing that it would lead to Molokai. I had learned as a child the joy of being alone, and I wanted that isolated country. My father was an agriculture teacher and newspaper editor. When I arrived as daughter number 6, he took me along in humorous desperation to gardens and fields and mountains where he had thought to take a son. I remember standing on his instep, clinging to his high, laced boots, and later running along the trail 6 steps to his 1. He died when I was 5, but I kept tramping out alone, smelling and tasting, and identifying in field guides the plants he knew so well. Summers in a wilderness were the best bequest he could have made. He had started building a cabin, and my mother took my older sisters and me back to it each year. We shingled and sawed, tore out the frozen plumbing after cold winters, and finally finished it 10 years later. After carpentry jobs, my share of house chores and hauling oak limbs for the wood stove, I went out alone to explore the ponderosa pine forest. I stalked deer at dusk and fireflies at night, ran wet and exultant in cloud bursts and thunderstorms, and climbed to the tops of young pine trees to swing them in whipping circles. In college at UCLA, I learned to swim, the most useful subject learned there. Then, by increasing distances, developed a lazy rhythmic stroke. Water became my element. I delight in its color, its texture, the three-dimensional freedom of movement. There where buoyancy balances body weight. I stagger in an alien world of gravity's pull when I first stand upright again on shore after an hour or two in and underwater. I married a seagoing man. He taught me bowline knots, warned of the barbed spines of the sea urchin, and drew diagrams of how a sailboat is able to tack into the wind. For 3 years, we eked out a living with our own commercial fishing boat, operating out of San Pedro, California, for albacore, halibut, abalone, and lobster, a hard, nasty, satisfying life. Between fishing trips, I worked as a lifeguard and swimming instructor, did helmet and skin diving, and hiked several hundred miles of trail and cross country. Children, as they were born, were tucked on back or on board and taken along. In 1952, we came to Hawaii as the lowest rank of all newcomers, transplants from California, West Coast haole. But Hawaii and living by the sea in the small country town of Haleiwa have been good teachers. The water skills of the mainland were adapted to Hawaii and its unceasing miracle of a warm ocean. One of the first scuba courses offered to the public in the islands was by a pair of Navy instructors. I finished it, then logged 300.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.